So tonight we're going to hear from Amy Brener. She's a participating artist here in GEOMAGIC, and she has these two fantastic resin sculptures in the center of the gallery towards the outer wall there. So if you get a chance after the talk to spend some time with those, I definitely recommend it. And then after Amy Brener, we're going to hear from Emily Johnson, and she's a professor here at New Mexico State University. And so she's an assistant professor of volcanology, Igneous, Petrology, and she's in the Department of Geological Sciences. So I just want to go ahead and introduce Amy Brener. Amy earned her MFA in sculpture from Hunter College in New York City, and she earned her BA in studio arts from the University of British Columbia in Vancouver. Amy's exhibited her work at the Weintraub Gallery in Berlin, the American Museum in Brooklyn, MoMA PS1 in New York City, McLaren Art Center in Ontario, Provincetown Art Association and Museum, the Deluge Contemporary Art in Victoria, and also the Marlborough Chelsea in New York City. So we're so excited to hear from Amy, and I'm gonna go ahead and turn it over to her via Skype, and she's gonna go through some images and talk to you about her practice. And let's go ahead and welcome Amy.
Okay, hi everyone. I just wanted to say hello first. I'm going to turn off my video and go into the screen slide presentation. This is the first time I've done a Skype talk, so it's a little strange, but just bear with me. Hopefully it'll go okay. I'm going to turn off. And thanks for coming. Thanks for having me. It's been great being in the show. Okay, I'm going to turn off this video and share the screen. Okay, I hope you can hear me. This is strange. All right, so because I can't hear you. So if you're laughing or booing or anything, I won't be able to hear it, but that's fine, okay. Playing, let me start, that's my name. Okay, I just was gonna play this video of a work that I, is everything okay? I can see you now, okay. All right. This is a video of a sculpture that I made in grad school. This is my thesis project. I don't usually show this, but I just think maybe it's a good way to see kind of where I was coming from when I first started making my resin works. This is from 2010. I just wanted to show that, you know, my process was really elaborate back then. There was a lot of different components. There were a lot of different components. There was video, sound, all these found objects, and little assemblages that I was making within the piece, within the sculptures. just to give you a sense, I mean, things got a little bit overcomplicated. I'm not going to explain, you know, all about what this work, you know, was dealing with, except for I was very interested in this, in the idea of contemporary grieving, and there was a lot of these health products that came into it. I was using a lot of kind of generic consumer goods and also very personal items, like this mold of my dad's face. He had passed away before I started grad school. And then there were some other personal elements, like this video of the sailboat I grew up traveling on with my parents. Just to give you a sense of kind of the complexity that I was dealing with at this time. There was running water. I'm going to move on. After grad school, I spent a couple years kind of really trying to figure out how to streamline the work, and I was very interested in making just standalone singular sculptures. And it took me a while, but I kind of realized that resin was the perfect material to bond together all these things that I was kind of trying to deal with before, but in a much more abstract way. So this is the first attempt. It was called Switchboard. It was from 2011. And it was the first large scale mold I made in which to pour resin. That was a very loose form. Obviously, it resembled a surfboard, so I was very interested in this idea of the vessel still carrying on from the grad school work. The underside had this this elaborate pattern of these switches and dials, or things that were meant to look like that. And there's even a remote control, a cast of a remote control embedded in there. And I had started using this the keyboard keys, which you'll still see in my work currently. This was the second work that I made, and then combining concrete, layered concrete and resin and different materials. So back then, I was very interested in this idea of, you know, the singular monolithic work, and something that had a striking shape from a distance, but then when you got up close, you could see an infinite amount of smaller details. And also, these works had a lot of light, reflective, and refractive materials inside them, for instance, Fresnel lenses, which enabled light to penetrate and bounce off them in strange ways. So when you moved around them, they would kind of change their appearance, similar to the ones that are in the show now, I believe. This work is titled Blade. Just to give you a sense of walking around it, they all have very slim profiles, maybe only a couple inches deep in some areas. I like this because I think it gives them, it creates a tension between them being kind of an image and a sculpture, and also maybe brings them into more of a digital space. I was thinking about video games and the way that sometimes things aren't fully articulated, and you walk past them in the video game and they're just actually this very thin surface layer of something. You can see in a lot of these there's this texture on the surface that resembles crystal or rock, and that was created just by pouring onto crinkled plastic. But it really did seem to have the effect of making it look like something more geologic. That in combination with the layering technique that I was using and the iridescence that I was creating by layering pigment. This is titled Sickle. This work was about 8 feet tall, so it was my largest at the time. And again, you can see the interest in layering the color and the pigment, and also different materials like concrete to create different effects. And I would pour it in very small layers. So maybe only, you know, a small cup full, two cups, you know, mixed together, would be one layer. So something like this would, you know, be upwards of 20 pours, maybe a lot more than that. I don't know. I've never counted, but I know it's a lot. This piece is titled Skaga. It's from 2012. And you can again see just the interest in color and form, but also in this light refraction. This is key. So when I was deciding on these forms, I would just go through a lot of different sketches, and I would just sketch out shapes until I found something that didn't really seem to refer to anything else. I mean, sometimes incidentally they would, but in approaching the form, I was always trying to kind of come up with something new. This is a different kind of thing, I suppose, because it's just a circle, but this was leaning against the wall. It leans against the wall. It's called Untitled Disc. Again, you can see the interest in the switchboard coming back into play along the sides, starting to embed more materials in the work again. This is Jotter, it's in the show. And with a lot of these works, I would create a really hard geometric edge on one side of the work, and then have the other side be softer, and much more organic. And I was interested in that idea of maybe one side referring to architecture and the other side referring to geology, and then the two coming together. Or in this one, the center serves as that more geologic looking area, whereas the outline of it is much more kind of rigid and defined. And again, you see the keyboard keys and, you know, different little bits and pieces coming back into the work. This is called Asterix. Okay, this is just to show you the way that I make them. So this is a very large work, so they're not always this complicated. But this was the largest work I had made at that point. This is in 2014. So the way they're made is I would make a wooden framework. And you can see on the far end, that's the side that would be the much more geometric side, hard edge side, and then just made out of kind of blocks of wood. And then the other side would be, you know, with some kind of foam or a different material that could create this softer edge. And then I would line up all the materials that were going to be in the surface layer and all the textures. You can see, I don't know if you can see my arrow, but actually, you probably can. These areas, these were just for texture, so I would peel this off afterwards. And then some of these other materials you'll see are embedded in the work. And then I just start pouring in many different layers. And this was the work right when it came out of the mold. It's often a very violent procedure to get them out of the mold. It requires a lot of chiseling, crazy like hammering and chipping away at them to get them to come out. But yeah, that was when it was born, I guess. And here's another photograph of it. It's called Shanty. It was definitely my largest work at that point. It's 7 feet tall by about 5 feet wide. And you can see all of these areas. Those were the textures I was talking about that I peel off at the end. And then I don't know if you can also see this, but this is my dad's face coming into it again. So this is around the time, yeah, when I started thinking I was going to start to incorporate that again. And I became interested in that idea of this very personal material coming back into the work. This is the backside of the work. So I don't know how many pores this piece took, but it was a lot. And the backside has a lot of this foam, which you press into. So it's a different process of the back of it than the front. But what I'm looking at when I'm pouring is the backside, not the front side. So I don't see this or the front of any of them until it comes out of the mold, which is a little nerve-wracking. But it's also part of it, not knowing exactly how it's going to come out. There's a detail in that one. This is titled Recliners, also from 2014. You can see that I'm becoming more open to letting found objects kind of show again in the work in a more overt way. And again, this idea of the switchboard and different little buttons and switches in the piece. And I was just going to say that interest, I think, was inspired greatly by science fiction movies or Star Trek. This idea that, you know, there are these elaborate switchboards and control panels and you don't know what they do. I mean, they might have one button that you know what function it serves, but the rest are completely mysterious and aren't actually real. So I just like this idea that you could kind of project, maybe you could project your own ideas onto what functions those could serve. I think that it comes through more in these works in particular, where you see the buttons becoming much more a part of the surface. This is called Bot. I think we're in 2015 now, or late 2014 maybe. And I was becoming more open to the idea of different temporalities coming into the work. One curator said that this reminded her of a giant Game Boy. Which I thought was interesting and funny, of course, but lately I've been more interested in letting different, you know, decades from the 20th century come into the work, not just kind of focusing. The previous work was much more dealing with the ancient past and the far future and those two things meeting. The newer work is more nuanced in that it, you know, deals with different aesthetics from different eras. This is titled Hanger from 2015. I was looking at a lot of different toys, like kids' toys like G.I. Joe's and stuff like that, and kind of just opening up to different aesthetic choices. This one was really crazy at the time when I made it. I just wasn't sure about it for ages. It's titled Dressing Screen, and it really cobbled together a lot of different elements. I made it when I was living in Provincetown, Massachusetts, at a residency, and there was a great free store, and a dump nearby, and so I was gathering a lot of different materials, and the work started incorporating many more found objects, again, in a much more obvious way. And also, also refer, starting to refer again to furniture. A lot of my previous work, from grad school was taking larger chunks of furniture and remaking them. So you can see the detail shot at that, and again, like these very intricate and complex textures on the surface as a result of multiple materials layering up on these on these molds and textures that I had. This is the work installed at PS1 for Greater New York. I just wanted to show, to give a sense of these large works together in a room. I was really lucky to be able to show these together, and it really has since pushed me to want to make large-scale work. Anyway, it was just a great opportunity to really look at the work. I think sculpture, when you have that kind of space, when you can have that kind of space around it, you learn a lot more, I think, from it, about your own practice. And I'm worried that I'm going over time, this is, you can feel free to cut me off if I am. This is a silicone work. During this time when I was making that dressing screen that I just showed, I'd also started making these silicone works that are completely flexible. They also have objects embedded in them, but they much more directly refer to the body and to the potential user or wearer of them. So I was interested in that, and the viewer being able to project themselves into these garments that they're called flexi shields. I was thinking a lot about this kind of flexible armor, something protective that was also decorative. They all contain these little kind of maybe helpful, maybe useful elements or medicinal plants or little tools that you could use potentially. And again, you see the face mold of my dad coming into them again. Here's another one. So birthday candles and little leaves and just kind of little hints of things. So again, being just interested in highly personal material being combined with just very ubiquitous, generic kind of things that have been incorporated to serve that have somehow been transformed. And repurposed, that's the word I was looking for, to serve other functions. So this is an example of, I've been trying to combine the resin work with the silicone work. This is titled Dressing Kit, and there's a lot of semi-useful things embedded in it. There's actually some eyeshadows and little fake eyelashes and things like that. So again, getting much more specific in what's incorporated into it. This is another one titled Dressing Kit, but much different. And these are really recent Omni Kit, this is called. Also Omni Kit. Okay, and that's all I have. And I'm worried that I'm going over, so I'm gonna go back to
hi. Thank you so much, Amy. That was incredible. Whoops. Tiffany Santos, the director of the Zuhl Museum and also the co-curator of GEOMAGIC, is going to introduce her. Okay, so I think volcanoes are fascinating for a variety of reasons. Clearly, there are destructive aspects of volcanoes. I could spend many lectures talking just about that. But volcanoes are also unique in that they not only destroy, but they also create. And I think most people, when looking at an image like this of a molten lava lake in Hawaii, see a solid rock behaving now as a liquid, is absolutely fascinating. Similarly, when you're looking at, say, a video of a lava flow, this is also on Kilauea volcano in Hawaii. You get to see beautiful molten lava erupting at the surface, and it's inherently something that's gorgeous to look at. You see these orange, beautiful hot flows, plus these silvery crusts of lava. And the other interesting aspect of volcanoes is the fact that they are capable of both destroying land, they're burying what was previously there under these new now ropey pohoihoi lava flows, but they're also creating new land. In fact, Hawaii would not be there without the volcanoes. Hawaii has created this, these volcanoes have created the land that the people now live on. So I want to talk more about the sort of creative aspect of volcanoes today and my fascination with them and other people's fascination with them as well. So another reason why people, of course, are interested in volcanoes, especially in the U.S., we have Kilauea in Hawaii, the other big volcano that we often think of is Mount St. Helens. And one reason why people are fascinated by volcanoes is simply how you get from picture A to picture B, right? So in the top image, that's Mount St. Helens taken from Johnston Ridge on May 17th, 1980. That's one day before the eruption began. And I took this photo also from Johnston Ridge this July, looking at the volcano from almost the same area. And looking at those two images, you wonder, well, where did all that material go? Why did this happen? The trees are clearly gone, and so you have both destructive processes, but then you see these massive volcanic deposits that you can use to interpret how the eruption progressed. So how did I become interested in volcanoes? It actually happened when I was pretty young. I was about 5 or 6 years old, I think, when this episode of Reading Rainbow aired. Did anybody else happen to see this episode of Reading Rainbow? Did anybody else love it as much as I did? So LeVar Burton went to Kilauea as, in this phase of activity at Kilauea, there was fire fountaining, as it's called. So that's the big fountain, hundreds of meters of lava being shot up into the air. And so that, of course, was captivating. And then the book that he highlighted that episode was called Hill of Fire, about a little cinder cone volcano that was born in a cornfield in Mexico. So where no volcano had previously existed, all of a sudden you have this volcano coming out of the ground. And I was absolutely taken with that, and that sort of spurred my lifelong love of volcanoes. And re-watching this episode, as I did actually this weekend, I thought this quote was really apt for this talk, which is that there's only one thing more spectacular than a volcano's ability to destroy, and that's its power to create. So that's what I'm going to focus on really for the rest of the talk. I also wanted to mention that volcanoes have been a source of inspiration not only for me, but for artists and and people for many centuries and probably millennia. Here are just a few images of artwork inspired by volcanic eruptions. The top two are from Mount Vesuvius in 1822 and 1774. And the bottom, lower image there on the left is from a woodblock print, a Japanese eruption in 1783. And on the right, Jorullo volcano in Mexico in 1814. And I think the reasons why people are interested in volcanoes are, first off, they are beautiful, especially their eruptions to watch. But a lot of these artworks serve too to document eruption processes. And they're actually very useful for geologists to go back and look at, say, especially that eruption of Vesuvius. You can actually go back and see things like volcanic lightning, how big the column was, how big the eruption may have been. And we can actually get useful information from those pieces of art as well. And volcanoes have also served many cultures in terms of sort of creation stories or explanations for the world around them. So on the left there is an image of what's the Greek mythology about Typhon, the demigod who has been buried underneath Mount Etna. So the idea was that Zeus and Typhon were fighting, and Zeus threw Mount Etna and buried Typhon beneath Mount Etna. Every time Typhon stirs or tries to get back up, the volcano erupts. And so that was a sort of a volcano creation explanation by the early Greeks. On the right is a beautiful photograph by Katja Kraft, taken of a Mount Loa lava flow in Hawaii. She entitled it Pele Dancing. And Pele is the Hawaiian goddess of fire and volcanoes. And there are many myths surrounding Pele that are ubiquitous sort of throughout the Hawaiian Islands. She is ubiquitous and thought to live at Kilauea. And there are lots of aspects of her either creating or destroying material on Hawaii as well. So I just wanted to highlight how important volcanoes really are to lots of different aspects of society. Okay, so for the rest of my talk, I just want to talk about sort of the main drivers of volcanic eruptions and what we can learn about them. So again, the two volcanoes I've mentioned, Kilauea on the left erupting in 1985, and Mount St. Helens erupting on the right in 1980. And just if you look at these two images, you can immediately tell that, first off, you're interested in why a volcano is erupting, but secondly, you're wondering why they look so different. So on the left, this is a hundreds of meter tall fire fountain, very red in color. And on the right, even though it's in black and white, the eruption column, as it's called, or the plume of material is quite gray, quite ashy, and it went some 6 miles up into the atmosphere. So first off, why is it that volcanoes erupt? We'll look at that a little bit. And then why do volcanoes erupt in different ways? And that's something that my research is trying to look at in part. And I want to present today, too, just some of the basic eruption products that I find to be really beautiful from these two different, very different eruption styles. So if you asked my five-year-old self why volcanoes erupt, this was my answer. I found this at my parents' house a few years ago. And it says on the left, when the pressure is great enough, you can buy the spelling, a volcano explodes, which isn't, you know, a terrible explanation for why a volcano erupts. I think that was also inspired by that Reading Rainbow episode. But the real reason that volcanoes erupt is because of gas. So much like taking the cork off of a champagne bottle or fastly removing the top of a soda bottle, gases will explode out of that liquid. And the reason being is that at high pressure, so if you have a pressurized bottle of champagne or soda, or if you have a pressurized magma, gas can actually dissolve in that liquid. And when you release that pressure, the gases that were once dissolved in liquid now form little bubbles. And you can form lots of bubbles, like the image on the left in the Mentos and Diet Coke experiments, where you force lots of bubbles to form very rapidly by dumping Mentos into a 2 liter of soda, and that creates what looks a whole lot really like a Hawaiian fire fountain. So really the idea behind all volcanic eruptions is that as magmas are rising to the surface, pressure decreases, and so you have gases that were once dissolved in the liquid, and now they move in or partition into little bubbles as bubbles start to form in your magma. And as that magma gets closer and closer to the surface, pressure decreases further bubbles grow, and that large volume of bubbles accelerates the magma to the surface. So some of the volcanic products that I study, broadly magmas, and magmas constitute melt, so molten rock, combined with perhaps crystals and either dissolved gas or exsolved bubbles. And those main volcanic gases that I'm interested in are the most important drivers of volcanic eruptions are listed there sort of in order of decreasing abundance. So water is the most abundant volcanic gas, then CO2, sulfur, chlorine, and fluorine. And again, in this little cartoon here, I'm showing that here you've got a magma, maybe it has a few crystals in it, so as magma gets close to the surface, it also cools down, little crystals start to form, and as it rises, the pressure decreases further and further, you get more and more bubbles, and eventually you have an eruption. So, interestingly, this idea about, well, we want to know something about volcanic gas because it's the driver of volcanic eruptions, the amount of volcanic gas in part governs how explosive eruption will be, but when a magma erupts, because all of this, the gases have moved into the bubbles, and the bubbles essentially just go up, sort of explode during eruption, if you were to analyze, say, a little chunk of rock that gets emitted during a volcanic eruption, that little chunk of rock actually has no measurable gas. So it's really hard to measure a rock and figure out how much gas that magma originally had. So how is it that we could measure volcanic gases? How can we understand the original gas content of magmas and maybe be able to explain how explosive eruptions may be or were? So there are two ways you could do this. I unfortunately chose the less exciting of these two ways. So the exciting way is to measure gases in plumes of active volcanoes. You can go to an actively erupting volcano and physically measure the gas content of the stuff coming out of the top. That's not what I do. I actually measure gases in what are called melt inclusions in crystals. So what is a melt inclusion? If you think back to this little cartoon, as that magma is rising and cooling down and little crystals are forming, you can get a little irregularity on the surface of the crystal here. And during that growth, that irregularity causes melt to be trapped inside this crystal. And we're talking about, say, a 100 micron bit of melt that's trapped. So by looking at these little melt inclusions, so if you have lots and lots, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of crystals that erupted, you can investigate, look at those crystals, find those crystals that have these little tiny bits of melt trapped. And those trapped bits of melt are basically preserving snapshots of the magma before it erupted. So I can analyze those little bits of melt and get the dissolved gases that were once in the melt. I can look at the magma composition before it erupted and basically piece together what that magma looked like before it went through whatever processes it went to and erupted. So this is basically what my research involves, and I view analyzing melt inclusions as kind of windows into the volcano. You get those pre-eruptive melt compositions and gas contents that are hard to get other ways. And frankly, I think they're quite beautiful. So this is one of the quartz crystals I've analyzed in the past. So this is a little quartz crystal ejected from a volcanic eruption in New Zealand. And all of these little blebs here are little bits of melt that were trapped in that quartz crystal that I can then analyze and find out something about the gas content and other compositional features of that magma. So that's sort of the volcanic products that I'm interested in, and it's interesting that in addition to creating and destroying material, volcanoes also give us products that enable us to learn more about the volcano itself. But from now on, I want to just focus on a few of the more beautiful volcanic products from those two sort of end members of the volcanic eruption types. So first off, Hawaiian-style eruptions, and then we'll look at the more explosive eruptions like Mount St. Helens later. So back to Kilauea volcano in Hawaii. This magma type that erupts here is what's known as basalt. It's a very hot and relatively fluid magma. It has a lower gas content overall than other magma types, which generally make these eruptions less explosive. The products of these eruptions include lava flows, as shown here, coming down the flanks of the volcano, and sometimes these beautiful fire fountaining slightly explosive events. So just to illustrate a few of the beautiful products of Hawaiian-style eruptions, many of these are named after the Hawaiian fire goddess Pele. And the first is what's known as Pele's hair. And if you were just to look at this image on the right, I think you'd probably guess that that was maybe a damp carpet. But this is actually the edge of Halemaumau Crater in Hawaii on the Kilauea volcano. And if you look up close on the image on the left, you can see these very fine, basically hairs. And they are very thin pieces of lava that have been sheared out in the wind at the top of one of these fire fountains. So these are basically tiny threads of volcanic glass that can be, say, this long to maybe a foot long at the longest. Although it looks soft, I would not advise sitting on this stuff as I did or picking it up. It's really sharp volcanic glass. And this is one of the stunning products of Hawaiian eruptions. Another Pele-themed volcanic product from Hawaiian eruptions is something called Pele's tears. They are these little sort of teardrop-shaped droplets of cooled magma, again, that come from these fire fountains. So as this lava sort of spraying into the sky, little tiny droplets get quenched in the atmosphere and then rain back down. You'll find big deposits of these glassy Pele's tears around some of these eruptions as well. And with the lava flows in Hawaii, you'll also get what are called lava trees. So when a lava flow encounters a forest, if the trees are sort of large enough, some of that lava gets caked onto the edge of the tree before the tree totally burns up and forms essentially a mold around the tree trunk. And you'll see huge forests that look now like this, where you have these big mounds of lava. In cases where you can actually, they've broken open, you can see the mold of the tree that eventually burned out in that lava flow. So these are really abundant on the island of Hawaii as well, these lava tree forests. Okay, so just to summarize some of those Hawaiian eruption products, you have Pele's hair and tears that are both coming from this fire fountain over here, getting the hair again is getting sheared out in the top of that fire fountain into those long strands. And then in lava flows, if that lava flow goes through a forest, you can get these beautiful lava trees. So switching gears a little bit to the more explosive side of things, Mount St. Helens again in 1980 exhibited what's called a Plinian eruption style. These are highly explosive eruptions. And these involve cooler, more viscous, or sort of stickier magmas. And this is another reason why they're so explosive. So not only do you have to worry about gas contents of the magma, but you need to worry about how easy it is for the gas to escape. So if you have a very fluid, sort of runny magma, it's a lot easier for the bubbles to get out than if you're dealing with a very thick, sticky magma, like in this case. So these eruptions typically involve lava types that are called dacite and rhyolite. They generally have higher gas contents, which also makes them more explosive. And the unique feature of these is these huge volcanic plumes. They look like this sort of mushroom cloud plumes of material. And they produce two types of major deposits that I wanted to show you guys images of: fall deposits and pyroclastic flows. So this shows the eruption of Mayon volcano in the Philippines in 1984, and I've highlighted the area that sort of produces these fall deposits. So here is the eruption column going up, and this is just an example of basically what goes up must eventually come down. Anything chucked up in this eruption is light enough to get carried up in the cloud, like pumice or ash, will fall back down eventually into these beautiful deposits. So here is a fall deposit of pumice, and pumice, I have an example if you guys want to come see, is this highly bubbly material that's incredibly lightweight. So this can actually, is light enough to get carried up into the plume and eventually rain back down. And this image on the left is showing an 8 meter thick fall deposit from one of the eruptions in New Zealand. And it's just full of these beautiful white pumice clasts. You can actually get them of all different magma compositions over here. This is a more basaltic eruption, and it has sort of black, but also similarly bubbly clasts that rain down out of the sky. You can also get much finer volcanic ash in these deposits as well. And the other major type of deposits or products from these big gradient-style eruptions are what are known as pyroclastic flows. And that's what you can see coming down the flanks of the volcano over here and down here. And these are very, very hot, fast-moving clouds of ash and gases, rock fragments and crystals, very devastating, but they leave behind really phenomenal deposits as well. On the left image here, you can see some of the deposits. They eventually solidify. They can be any range of colors, from white to pink to gray to black. And this is actually Rowan, when he was a wee baby. We dragged him out on a volcanology field trip to look at one of these pyroclastic flow deposits. And here on the right, there's a student for scale. This is up in the Oregon Mountains, actually. And the Oregon Mountains are full of these massively thick pyroclastic flow deposits. So the southern portion of the Oregon Mountains represents these exact type of Plinian eruption deposits. You can see these incredibly large blocks of material that got picked up and were rejected in this flow, and the rest of this is sort of fine ash and pumice that's all been deposited by that big eruption. Okay, so that was sort of a whirlwind tour of volcanic eruption products. And one other product I want to mention, sort of a rather a byproduct of volcanism, I wanted to mention, because of course this is part of the fabulous Zuhl collection, is the formation of petrified wood. And I should say that not all petrified wood directly involves volcanoes, but most of it involves volcanic ash in some way that had to have been present in the environment to begin with. And in some cases, these are formed by what are known as lahars, which are essentially volcanic mud flows. So anywhere where you have an abundance of volcanic ash and you mix that ash with water, you end up with this very cement-like, muddy flow that contains high amounts of silica, and that's really the key to preserving and altering these logs into what we see as petrified wood. So this example here is from Oregon. This is in the John Day Fossil Beds National Monument in the Clarno unit, which is some volcanic mud flow unit. And that particular piece of petrified wood is 50 centimeters in diameter and about 2.5 meters long. And then if you slice that open and polish it, that's what we have preserved in the Zuhl collection, where that wood has been replaced by silica and trace minerals that give it the different colors that you see in the petrified wood. Okay, so to come full circle back to my inspiration for studying volcanoes, again, LeVar Burton's episode of Reading Rainbow on Kilauea and Hill of Fire. For me personally, this, again, was fairly life-changing, especially given that pericotine, the cinder cone that he mentioned in the Hill of Fire, the volcano born in a cornfield in Mexico, is one of the cinder cones I ended up studying for my PhD. So here is pericotine, that cinder cone, lava flows that buried the village, and there's the steeple of the church just sticking out there. And there I am with new cornfields planted just outside the lava flow field, doing work there in 2007. And I also got to finally go to Kilauea and stay on the edge of Holly Mountain Crater and see active eruption in Hawaii. So I think my five-year-old self would be pretty pleased with what I ended up doing. And not to get too cheesy, but if there is something that you're really inspired by and really love, do it, because it will make you happy. So thank you very much.
Of a trying to build geologic courses, and the impetus to do that, via, you know, post-apocalyptic situation in which those don't exist anymore, and they're kind of like fetishized. I've always been interested in combining synthetic and organic materials, and I think it comes from that, and also just the quality of the resin in general, you know, just what it can do and what it can, the surfaces that you can create. I think, you know, the experimentation of starting to make those sculptures, I think led to it, just seeing the way that it can approximate something like glass or crystal was interesting because it is such, when you see it in person, it's so apparent that it's plastic, whereas an image, it doesn't really maybe come across as much, but I'm sure the sculptures that are in the gallery, I think, have that quality too. I mean, they resemble crystals in some way, but they also still very much have a synthetic look to them. Does that answer the question? Thanks.
And so, Amy, I have a question for you too. So I was wondering if you could speak to the weather quality, especially of the two sculptures that we have here. The longer we've had them, we've noticed, like, the more you look, you start to really see, like, all those different pieces in there, and you really see, like, beyond the crystal quality of it, that you start to really see, like, linear quality that's built in to the structure itself, almost like fissures that are kind of like everywhere, but they're combined to make these sculptures.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's a result of the layering process. Oops. Can you hear me now? Sorry, I think I muted it for a second.
Oh, yeah, we're good. I'm muting it on my side too. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, the layering and the fissure, the fissures and the cracks and whatnot are a result of the layering and also the kind of chiseling method that I use afterwards in a lot of them, breaking apart the layers. And I am interested in that weathered look. I think to make them look like they've kind of come through a great deal of time to get here, time travel and, you know, ideas of the past and future meeting, and there being kind of this, I don't know, and that being apparent on the surface of the works, this impact, I guess, is something I was interested in. Sorry, I missed the last part of what was said.
So she's talking about the very narrow bases that you addressed, the thinness of some of them and related them to video games. But just if you could talk about the precariousness of the bases, like the kind of like the slenderness and the, you've really gone for kind of like a less is more approach. Like you've just gone for like, it seems like you've gone for exactly what you need to keep it upright, but no more.
Very economical. Well, I don't know. It's hard to. It's a formal decision. I mean, I like that precariousness and the tension that it does bring to the work. But yeah, I mean, when I talked about before, them having these slim profiles that bring them more into maybe a digital realm is kind of where that came from. But also. Just a formal decision based on, I don't know, for some reason when things have more depth, they feel somehow more like things I've seen before. I didn't want to have a heavy base, because that brings it more into like the sculpture, brings it more into kind of the classical sculpture dialogue. which I'm not particularly interested in. So I really want them to be this kind of new approach to sculpture and to form. And I was trying to find a way that they could stand without having any kind of pedestal or base for that reason, and to kind of bring them out of that dialogue. So this wedge base was the solution for me, at least for those works.
Thanks so much. That's great. And so for Emily, too, I just was wondering, with your research, kind of how that works for you in more general points of your life, and then also like how you're seeing the show from your perspectives. Oh, sure, if you'd like to. Yeah.
So for me, in terms of what my research interests are, I guess I'm just still really interested in trying to work out sort of the origins of volcanic eruptions and what governs the way, you know, why eruptions behave the way they do. And for me, using the melt conclusions, I'm able to study a lot of ancient eruptions. So for example, the Oregon Mountains is one of the places that I've worked and were able to study the melts preserved in this 36 million year old volcanic eruption and see things that otherwise are not visible. I can't go out there and measure the gases from that eruption, see what they were like by looking at these little tiny products. So I think, I guess, part of my research is studying sort of single volcanic systems as well as looking at bigger volcanic provinces and comparing and contrasting different eruption types throughout provinces. And as far as sort of how, I mean, for me, I find a lot of the stuff in this exhibit really relatable. Of course, the minerals that are here and the petrified wood, a lot of these relate to volcanic processes. And it's just sort of fascinating that one thing I'm struck by is how many people are impacted by geology who aren't geologists, you know? And I think that's really visible in the petrified wood exhibits and in Amy's work and a lot of these pieces where non-geologists find geology just as fascinating as I do, really.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
So you touched on sort of how volcanoes can be inspirations for artists, and I'm wondering if you touch on that in your class, or is that something you just put into this presentation?
It's actually something that I guess I sort of was taught from one of my professors at University of Oregon, Professor Kathy Cashman, and who's also a volcanologist, was also very fascinated by volcano myth stories, and so it's something she often brought up in her lectures. When I teach volcanology here, I do bring it up a little bit, but it's not something I've integrated into my intro class, and I'm thinking maybe that'd be something I would like to
do. Like a nice intersection.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yeah.
It's a little off of your research, I know, but it's a question I've actually been wanting to ask you for a while, so I'm going to take the opportunity to ask you. So you talked about the petrified wood, but another part of the Zuhl collection that we're really kind of known for is our geodes, and can you kind of give an explanation on that process? Because I give my explanation during my tours, but
well, the geodes can form in a variety of different ways, and the only geodes I'm very familiar with are those that are associated with pyroclastic flows, actually. And so in those big ash clouds that are sort of solidifying, you can get big bugs or pockets of gas that form in them. And over time, fluids can get trapped in there or circulate into those cavities, and crystals can grow in those cavities with heat from that sort of cooling flow plus water. So it can be sort of as the flow is cooling or kind of a post-depositional thing, if you can have water circulating into those cavities and then those minerals form from those waters over time. Yeah, that's not something I know a ton about.
Yeah.
The only geodes I've found are in pyroclastic flows. I think they can form in other rock types if you have those cavities and hot fluids present, but you need kind of those two key things.
Thank you guys so much for being here tonight, and Emily and Amy, thank you so much for your insights. I really appreciate everything that you shared with us.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.